This section of the course will look at practical applications of AI planning and the use of plans when executed. It'll also describe some common themes found in many practical AI planners.
Plans only become useful when they're executed. Even the earliest AI planners were linked with plan execution capabilities, as shown by the use of the Strips planner alongside the PLANEX plan executor over 40 years ago in the Shaky Robot. Sakadote's NOAA planner was used to follow along while an apprentice engineer repaired a hydraulic pump, and the system maintained a model of the state of the pump to be able to suggest fixes when the apprentice ran into problems. Nonlin maintained the goal structure or rationale behind plan elements, and could use this as the basis for plan execution monitoring to spot significant divergences between the required outcomes and activity and their later uses to satisfy constraints in the plan. In some cases, alternative contributors to satisfy those required constraints could be found in the existing plan without changing it. In other cases, problems could be spotted well in advance and suitable changes made before the problem became critical. SRI International's work on SIPE and PRS, the procedural reasoning system, used rich representations of plans and processes to support execution and recovery from errors. Work at the University of Essex in the UK created a reactive planner, which maintained a representation of the flaws in the plan, whether those arose at plan time or during execution. It could apply fixes to these flaws in a uniform manner to provide an integrated planning, execution, and monitoring framework. Work in Chicago on RAP explored a reactive agent architecture for representing plans that were suitable for real-time plan execution monitoring in robots, for example. Our own OPLAN system included algorithms for plan repair and replanning in both high tempo and less time-constrained situations when execution monitoring indicated problems. What's not at all surprising is that many of the AI planners which were created to address practical applications also included techniques support execution and monitoring of the outcome of plan execution. We'll now look in some depth at a good example of how AI planning and plan execution techniques were used in practice. We'll see the importance of integrating planning into other key systems for real-time task assignment, system diagnosis, condition monitoring, and execution time plan repair. Deep Space One launched from Cape Canaveral in 1998 and tested 12 advanced high-risk technologies in space, including ion thrusters and advanced onboard automation. In a successful extended mission, it operated through to 2001 and encountered Comet Borrelly. Deep Space One included a remote agent experiment, RAX, to demonstrate both ground-based and onboard AI and remote plan execution. The spacecraft control application domain posed some tough requirements. High reliability was essential, and issues could arise from single-point system failures or from more complex multiple-cause problems. Deep Space One operated under tight resource constraints for fuel and power, and frequently there would be multiple goals which could not all be satisfied at the same time. Of course, given the nature of a very high-speed flyby of a target comet, deadlines were fixed and very tight. There's no second chance of return if essential observations and scientific goals are not achieved due to some precondition not being satisfied or some systems not being fully prepared at the critical time. Spacecraft did have sensors to report its status and the status of its instruments, but these only provide limited observability of the many conditions under which the spacecraft can operate. And of course, many things can be happening at the same time on a spacecraft, and some operations can take a long time to complete once started. There's no possibility of fully ordering and completing one activity before another must begin. So Deep Space One posed a very interesting and realistic example of a remote device that we might wish to control via more automated AI planning methods. The Deep Space One remote agent approach was to use constraint-based planning and scheduling. It had to deal with robust multi-threaded execution of the activities, and it had to integrate with model-based fault diagnosis and reconfiguration. Real-time control and monitoring the spacecraft was the key issue. Deep Space One could operate at various levels of autonomy. It could execute single commands or sequences of activities which had to be executed at some particular times. It could seek to achieve some given goal. It could maintain a model of the state of the spacecraft and detect errors from incoming sensor information. It could deal with a scripted plan and decompose that into greater levels of detail. And it could deal with onboard, back-to-back plan generation, execution and plan recovery in its most autonomous mode. This table provides a summary of the levels of autonomy onboard Deep Space One and shows what elements can be done on the ground, on the onboard planner and scheduler, and on the onboard execution system. So this goes right through to the most autonomous modes where plans can be prepared on the ground, they can be completed on board the spacecraft, taking into account the situation the spacecraft's in, and can be autonomously executed. So Deep Space One systems cover everything from the ground control through what's happening on the spacecraft itself. It involves planning, execution, and monitoring of the outcome of plans. Deep Space One remote agent experiment functionality includes the Planner Scheduler Mission Manager, which deals with the onboard generation of plans, dealing with replanning when failures occur and so on. The Executor provides the low-level commanding interface but links back to the planner to initiate onboard planning when it's needed. And there's a link to the mode identification recovery, our diagnosis system on the spacecraft, to make sure that we can confirm command execution meets its objectives. Deep Space One planning could deal with a diversity of goals. Final state goals such as turn off the camera once you're done using it. Scheduled goals such as communicate to Earth at pre-specified times. Periodic goals such as ensuring you take a picture for navigation purposes every 2 days. Information-seeking goals, such as asking the onboard navigation system to return its profile for the thrusters. Continuous accumulation goals, such as making sure that over a given period, you make sure you accumulate enough thrust, but these actions don't have to be done at specific times. And then default goals, such as when you've got nothing else to do, point the high-gain antenna back to the Earth to maintain good communications with the Earth. And it could deal with the diversity of constraints. State action constraints, such as to take a picture, the camera must be on. Dealing with finite resources, such as power constraints. Dealing with true parallelism, where, for instance, the attitude control system must work in parallel with the ion propulsion system controller. Functional dependencies, example is the duration of a turn depends on its source and its destination. Continuously varying parameters, such as counting the amount of accumulated thrust, and deal with constraints that come from other kind of specialized modules, such as the onboard navigation system. A Deep Space One plan is in the form of timelines of the different instruments and when they're turned on and off, and various constraints, time constraints, and other kinds of constraints apply between the elements of this plan. This tool shows the status of the EXEC system on board the spacecraft. A Java applet was provided to allow observers to watch the remote agent experiments in real time while it was operating. The actual flight experiment for Deep Space One remote agent experiment took place between 17th and the 21st of May 1999. RAX was activated and controlled the Deep Space One spacecraft autonomously, but some issues and alarms did arise. There was a divergence of the predicted value of the state of the ion propulsion system and the actual observed values. This was determined to be due to the infrequency of real-time monitor updates on the spacecraft. The EXEC deadlocked in use. The problem was diagnosed and a fix was designed quickly, but it was not uploaded to Deep Space One for fears of the safety of the flight systems. This condition hadn't appeared in thousands of ground tests, which indicates the need for formal verification methods for this type of safety and mission-critical software. Following later experiments, RAX was deemed to have achieved its aims and objectives. RAX controlled the spacecraft autonomously for 2 days. On the first day, typical operations took place. The ion propulsion system was turned on and off at various times. The attitude control system was operated when appropriate, some images were taken, some onboard planning was performed. The second day included the injection of some simulated failures of the radiometric tracking and thruster systems, in order to show how the planner could cope with these events. The final report of the Deep Space One remote agent experiment concluded that the validation objectives had been achieved. The system was able to deal with both ground-based and onboard autonomously generated plans and execute those plans in the face of failures and replan where required. And it did this through capabilities which included robust goal-based commanding and integration with the onboard model-based fault recovery system. So, to summarise, Deep Space One remote agent experiment featured an AI planner outer level with replanning capability, detailed constraint handling for time and resources, integration with system diagnostics and analysis, integration of plan execution and monitoring, rich domain description languages, and involved comprehensive user interfaces.